Good evening, everyone. Welcome back to in-person physical worship after yet another church lockdown. Welcome in particular to this Good Friday service. Welcome to those of you who are gathered here in the meeting house and to those in the church hall, and also to those who will be looking at this service on the internet as well. Thank you all for coming. It's good to see that so many have come along for this Good Friday service tonight. I want to thank all those who have prepared the meeting house and prepared the halls for this service tonight. Thank you to those people who worked so hard to do that, and also to those who will clean afterwards in preparation for the Easter Sunday morning service. So, we meet here again, therefore, this coming Sunday, Easter Sunday, morning worship at 11:30 a.m. There will be no Zoom service on Sunday night. Instead, you can access the moderator's pre-recorded service, and the links for that have already been sent out. I want to take this opportunity to thank Amanda Munro, and also the members of the praise band and one or two other people who have been leading the praise in our internet services during the past 3 months. Thanks also to those who assisted in other ways, reading the word and leading in prayer, as well as those people week by week who have assisted us with our technology as well. We're very grateful to all who have helped out in all of these ways. At the end of the service tonight, would you please follow the directions of the stewards? They will guide you with regard to exiting the building, so cooperate with them. Remember perhaps to sanitize your hands on the way out. And I know, because we've all been apart for so long, that there is the temptation to bunch up together and to talk to each other, but try to refrain from doing that. Don't gather in huddles out in the car park, but make your way home again, or to wherever you may be going after the service. So, this is Good Friday. This is a pivotal day in the church's calendar. We are here to worship God and to meditate again on how he so loved us as to give his son to save us. In Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 5, verses 6 to 8, we read these words: "You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." So, mindful of what God did, what the Lord Jesus has done for us, let us praise him, remaining seated and singing softly our opening praise: "How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure."
Bye.
Would you please stand for prayer? Let's join our hearts together in prayer. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we bow our hearts before your throne of grace. It is our privilege, Lord God, to worship you, to praise you, to pray to you, to read your word, to hear you speaking into our hearts. And we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity that has been restored to us to gather in this familiar place and here to unite our hearts in worship of you. Lord God, we know it was your plan from all eternity to send your Son to save your people. We think of that promise given at the dawn of human history that the woman's seed would crush the serpent's head. We think of how that promise gained momentum throughout the Old Testament until it reached its fulfillment in the New. We think of how the angels announced to the shepherds, "Unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." So we rejoice that the Savior came on a mission of mercy, on an errand of love. We rejoice in the words that he spoke and the life that he lived. And we thank you that he took his perfect life to the cross and there laid it down for imperfect people like us. Lord, we know that on that cross, Jesus was forsaken that we might be forgiven, abandoned that we might be accepted, rejected that we might be received, that there he died that we might live. So as we meditate tonight on his dying love for the likes of us, may we be drawn closer to him. May our love for him be deepened. May our service for him be enriched. We pray, Lord, that you would therefore grant the help of your Spirit to all gathered in these premises and those who will look at the service at home. Grant the help of your Holy Spirit to the preacher in the pulpit and to the people in the pews. Grant the help of your Spirit to all as we listen and learn and as we worship you. And even through this time of worship, may the people of God be blessed and strengthened for further service. And we pray, Lord, that there would be those, even on this Good Friday evening, those who for the first time will hear and heed the gospel call. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Now, I understand that Amanda and Rosemary are going to sing a duet, Lead Me to Calvary, King of My Life, and they will be accompanied on the guitar by Daniel.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Amanda and Rosemary and Daniel. That was lovely. And may we indeed be led in our thoughts tonight to Calvary. And we're going to now hear a passage of Scripture read, which does essentially lead us to Calvary. It's from the book of the prophet Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 53. It's being read from the Authorized Version of the Bible, and Louise is now going to read to us the Word of God.
Isaiah 53. Who hath believed our report, and to him is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of the dry ground. He hath no form, no comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he had borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we were healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was opposed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He had brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shears is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut out of the land of the living, for the transgression of my people was he stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he had no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it was pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see of the trouble of his soul, and shall be satisfied. For his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he had poured out his soul unto death. And he was numbered with his transgressors, and he bare the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. Amen.
Thank you, Louise. May God add his blessing to the reading of his precious word. Would you please stand again for our prayers of intercession, our prayers for others? Let us again unite our hearts before God in prayer. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, on this Good Friday, we remember again all that your Son went through for us, how he voluntarily endured sorrow, suffering, and death for our sake, how he identified with humanity, standing alongside the brokenhearted, accepting the limitations of life and death. We think of how he endured the agony of Gethsemane. And so we pray tonight, O Lord, for those who suffer from mental illness, especially for those whose condition has been triggered or exasperated by these repeated periods of lengthy lockdown. We think of how he endured the physical suffering on Golgotha. And so we pray for those who are suffering physically tonight. We pray for those who are currently suffering from COVID-19 and for those still suffering from the results of COVID-19. We pray also for those suffering from other forms of illness, and in some cases whose treatment has been delayed because of the coronavirus pandemic. As we pray for those suffering physically, so, Lord, we pray for doctors, specialists, nurses, all medical practitioners, and all in our valuable National Health Service who are still seeking to bring help to such people in such situations. We think of how Jesus died on that central cross on that first Good Friday. We know how devastated his followers were in the immediate aftermath of his death. So, Lord, we pray this evening for all who have been bereaved over these past months. Enable such people to draw upon the good memories they had of their loved ones, but enable them also to remember that the Christ who died on Good Friday rose victorious on Easter Sunday and robbed death of its sting and the grave of its prey, and in his ascension into glory opened heaven's door to all who trust and believe in the Savior. We think of how the disciples initially deserted Jesus on that Good Friday. And so we pray for those tonight whose faith has been battered by the storms of life, by the harsh realities of this fallen world, even at times by the rough and tumble of church life. We know how Jesus restored those disciples again, how he encouraged them again, and how they returned to fellowship and fruitfulness at his command. And so we pray that those who have grown cold may be warmed again to a new discipleship. We pray, Lord, that those who have grown lethargic may be reinvigorated again. And we pray also, Lord, that those who are dead in their transgressions and sins may be raised from their spiritual graves and hear the voice of Christ the Lord bidding them come to him. And we pray, Lord, that such people would come, that they would respond to the gospel call, and they would find in Christ that one who saves to the uttermost and saves forever. Hear us, Lord, because once more we offer these, our prayers, to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Remaining seated, we sing the hymn, Man of Sorrows, What a Name. Remaining seated and singing softly.
Savior.
Imagine walking into the temple of some unfamiliar religious sect or cult and seeing as the centerpiece a scaffold from which people could be hanged, or a guillotine for beheading people, or perhaps an electric chair in which people could be executed. If you went into such a place and saw such things in front of you, you would probably assume that it was the place of a religion far removed from Christianity. And yet the cross was the first century Roman equivalent of those things that I've just mentioned, except that the cross was far more painful, far more ugly, far more degrading than any of them. But the cross, strange though it might sound, the cross was central to the whole mission of Jesus. And of course, it is central to the ministry and the message of the church. And Jesus himself lived as though his death was the most important thing he came to do. He chose his time to die. But there can be no doubt that he regarded it as central to everything that God desired of him. As the late Reverend Dr. John Stott, a renowned British commentator, as John Stott put it, the hour for which he had come into the world was the hour in which he left it. And so tonight I want to consider with you three different aspects, therefore, of the death of Christ. First of all, Christ's death was anticipated. Christ's death was anticipated. And that crimson thread of the anticipation of his death runs through the entire Old Testament. As soon as Adam and Eve had sinned, God made a specific promise. God spoke, you remember, to the serpent who had enticed them to disobey God. God spoke to the serpent and said to the serpent, I will put enmity between you and the woman and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head and you shall bruise his heel. And it's worth noting even in that early promise of the coming of the Savior, it's worth noting there that only the seed of the woman actually is mentioned. Hence, there is contained therein a prophecy of the virgin birth. And indeed, Christ bruised the head of the serpent, Satan, as he conquered sin and death by dying and rising again. Leapfrog with me from Genesis chapter 3 through to Psalm number 22. And there in Psalm 22, we find more anticipation of the death of Christ. Because in Psalm 22, David recorded the very words that would be found in the lips of Jesus and prophetically described the work of Christ as a servant atoning for sin. Words that are familiar to us. They are familiar to us coming from the lips of Jesus and all that happened to Jesus. But here they are back in Psalm 22. My God, why have you forsaken me? All those who see me laugh me to scorn. They shoot out the lip. They shake their head, saying, he trusted in the Lord. Let him rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It has melted within me. Leapfrog a bit further with me to that passage that Louise read for us earlier in the book of the prophet Isaiah. 700 or so years before Jesus' birth, Isaiah the prophet wrote prophetically anticipating the coming Messiah, words that are so familiar to us. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him, the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. And then when you leapfrog, and I'm only, there's many more anticipations contained in the pages of the Old Testament. I have mentioned just now only three. But when you leapfrog again into the early pages of the New Testament, again the anticipation continues. Because you remember, even before Jesus was actually born, the angel said to Joseph, "You will call him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." And then when Jesus himself started upon his public ministry, again he anticipated his own death. He said, "The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." And when it dawned upon the disciples who he really was, when the penny dropped as to who he really was, when the penny dropped in their minds, then we are told from that time Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised again the third day. So the death of Christ was anticipated. Anticipated in the Old Testament, anticipated in the early announcements of his birth, anticipated by Christ himself and what he said about himself. So the cross then was not an emergency measure. Christ was not caught unawares or taken by surprise when he was betrayed, arrested, mauled, manhandled, tortured, crucified. Christ was the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. As soon as man had sinned, God unveiled his plan and gave his promise. Thousands of years later, as man did his worst, God gave his best and fulfilled the anticipation of the ages. Christ's death then was anticipated. And if you are one of his tonight, through saving faith in him, does it not on this Good Friday, even though we remember the horribleness of his death, does it not nevertheless warm the cockles of your heart to know that God had a plan from all eternity to save you, and that nothing prevented God unfolding his salvation program? And in the midst of these days in which we're living and these times in which we are living. In the midst of dark and difficult times, is it not good to know that God is on the throne and he is working out his plan and looking after his own? Christ's death then was anticipated. Secondly, Christ's death was accomplished. Christ's death was accomplished. When Jesus on the cross cried out, "It is finished," this was not the defeated moan of a dying man, but rather the victorious cry of a victorious man, the victorious cry of Christ's completed work. The Greek word tetelestai that's used here actually means, in a sense, completely complete, perfectly perfect. What Christ had come to do by his death on the cross, that work was completely complete, perfectly perfect, finished. Many things in this world are not finished. You have heard of an unfinished symphony. You sometimes see buildings that are never actually completed. People sometimes begin to write stories, and the story is never actually really completed. But Jesus, at the age of 33, finished, completed the work he had come to do. And in the completing of that work, how ghastly it was. F.W. Farrar, in his book, The Life of Christ, describes the awful physical trauma of execution by crucifixion. Listen to what F.W. Farrar says about crucifixion. "For indeed a death by crucifixion seems to include everything that is horrible and ghastly. Dizziness, cramp, thirst, starvation, sleeplessness, traumatic fever, tetanus, shame, publicity of shame, long continuance of torment, horror of anticipation, mortification of untended wounds, all intensified just up to the point at which they can be endured, but all stopping just short of the point which would give to the sufferer the relief of unconsciousness. The unnatural position of the body on the cross, the unnatural position made every movement painful. The lacerated veins and crushed tendons throbbed with incessant anguish. The wounds, inflamed by exposure, gradually gangrened. The arteries, especially at the head and stomach, became swollen and oppressed with surcharged blood. And while every variety of misery went on gradually increasing, there was added to them the intolerable pang of a burning, raging thirst. Man did his worst against Jesus, yet it was all in God's plan. Because, as we were reminded in that passage from Isaiah 53, it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. The Lord makes his life a guilt offering. God laid on his son the weight of the world's sin, the vile deeds that hit the headlines, as well as the everyday sins of us all, were compacted onto the pure, holy, spotless, undefiled Jesus. like a railway guard's van with its brakes applied, standing still as the weight of all the goods wagons are shunted onto it. You've probably seen in a film or something like that, you've probably seen the guard's van, its brakes applied, standing there, and all the other goods vehicles shunted onto it. Well, in a sense, as Christ stood under the crushing load of the sin of the world, it was all shunted onto him, all piled onto him. He paid the price of every last wrong thought, word and deed, past, present, and future, sins of wrong attitudes and actions, sins of omission and commission, of things remembered by us and sins forgotten by us. But they were all shunted onto Christ. He was actually smitten by God and afflicted. And yet, there was even more, because at this point came the coup de grace. Even worse than bearing all that sin, even worse was the inevitable consequences of it. Because for the first time in his life, Jesus was cut off from his Father because of our sin. Our sin separated him from his Father and caused God's face to be hidden. The grief this caused Christ was, of course, expressed in that most agonizing of cries from the cross, "My God, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" Yet all of this was in fulfillment of the plan of the loving triune God. For God so loved the world. God so loved you and me. He so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And so on this Good Friday, as we meditate on the horribleness of the cross, we've still got to remember that Christ's death was accomplished by the will of the Father to save the likes of you and me. Christ's death then was anticipated, and Christ's death was accomplished. And then thirdly, Christ's death must be appropriated, or if you like, applied. Christ's death must be applied to our lives. God's greatest offer to each individual is that he will forgive. He will forgive any who come to him. God is not in a hurry to judge, though judge he must. For example, you remember the door of Noah's Ark remained open 7 days as an invitation to all who enter. The door stood open for whosoever would enter into that ark. We know in the end only Noah and his family entered into the ark, but the door stood open there as an indication of God's long-suffering mercy. The door open for those who would come in. God is not, you see, in a hurry. He is not in a hurry to judge. Rather, he is in a hurry to save. You remember the well-known parable of the prodigal son, Christ's parable. You remember in that parable, the father ran. Even though the son had gone into the far country and wasted his time and wasted his money and was reduced to the level of a pig, when the father saw the son coming, the father ran to meet him. God is not in a hurry to judge. God is in a hurry to save those who will turn in repentance and faith to him, a God who is patient, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Martin Luther, the great German reformer, once received a letter from a distressed monk. This monk was agitated about his standing before God, and peace with God seemed to be eluding this monk. And he wrote to Luther to see if Luther could help him. And Luther wrote back to him and replied, saying this to the distressed monk: "Learn to know Christ and him crucified. Learn to sing to him and say, 'Lord Jesus, you are my righteousness. I am your sin. You took on you what was mine, yet set on me what was yours. You became what you were not, that I might become what I was not.'" Luther there was referring to that great transference, as it were. We take our sin, our shame, our guilt, we transfer it on to Christ, and he transfers to us his perfect righteousness. Many of you have maybe heard of Holman Hunt's famous painting, The Light of the World. It's one of my favorite pieces of Christian art, and you maybe have seen that picture, Holman Hunt's picture, Jesus, the Light of the World, and it depicts Jesus standing, and his head is crowned with thorns, and he's holding in one hand a kind of a lantern, and he's standing outside a door, and the door hasn't been opened for a long time, if ever. There's thorns and brambles growing around the door. It's closed. And Jesus is standing, holding a lantern in one hand, the other hand knocking at the door. And of course, the handle to the door is on the inside. That's a well-known picture. But did you know that Holman Hunt painted another picture called The Scapegoat? The Scapegoat. It's not as well known because it's in a private art gallery in Manchester, though there's a copy of it in the public art gallery in Manchester as well. I had the privilege of seeing that particular painting a few years ago. And Holman Hunt actually regarded The Scapegoat picture as his major work. In fact, he spent 2 years on the shores of the Dead Sea, off and on over 2 years, painting this picture, The Scapegoat. It's a meticulously accurate painting of a goat which is dying, slumping under the weight of some enormous unseen burden. And the title explains the picture. This is the scapegoat that is referred to in Leviticus chapter 16. The scapegoat which is used on the Day of Atonement. And on the Day of Atonement in the Jewish calendar, the high priest took a goat, and he would symbolically lay his hands on the head of the goat, and he would confess the sins of the people of Israel over the goat, transferring, as it were, onto the goat all the sins of the people of Israel. And then the goat would be driven away out, out of Jerusalem, into the wilderness to die, symbolically carrying away, bearing away the sins of the people, so that the people themselves might escape. Their sins were transferred onto the goat. The goat carried the sins of the people away. Well, Holman Hunt in painting that picture, the scapegoat. In a sense, he was, of course, referring to what Christ did. He is our scapegoat. And you remember, he was driven out of Jerusalem. He was crucified outside the city wall. Christ, our divine scapegoat, carried our sins away. But the question I want to ask you tonight is this: have you done, in a sense, what that Jewish high priest did? Have you yourself, as it were, have you come to Christ? Have you laid your hands upon him, upon his head? Have you confessed your sin, your unworthiness, your guiltiness before a holy God? Have you laid your hand on his perfect substitute, the scapegoat, Jesus Christ, and transferred all your sin and guilt onto him? Have you? As you search your own heart tonight on this Good Friday, have you done that? Has there been a time in your life when you know for sure that that has happened? And if it hasn't happened, then why not even tonight? Why not tonight, on this Good Friday, on this night when we have been able to come again to this place to worship? Why not tonight say, I lay my sins on Jesus, the spotless Lamb of God. He bears them all and frees us from the accursed load. Why not recognize what he can do for you, bearing shame and scoffing root in my place? Condemned he stood, sealed my pardon with his blood. Hallelujah, what a Savior. And if it's true of you that you have already recognized what Christ has done for you in bearing your sin outside the city wall, if you've already trusted in him, then of course know that your conversion, whenever that first took place, that's not the end of the story, but simply the beginning of a new kind of life, a life lived out every day in the light of the cross. The secret of that new life, that Christian life, is not just to say, he died for me, but also to add, and I died with him. Christ is meant to be my substitute, not only in death, but in life, so that the life I now live is no longer mine, but the life of Christ who now lives in me. And so, Christian, if you're ever tempted, as it were, to yield to temptation, Christian, if you're ever tempted to lower your standards to the world's ways, then remember again, oh, remember again what the Savior has done for you, that your sins might be forgiven. Remember what the Savior has done for you, that you might flee from sin. Remember the blood he shed. Remember the accomplishment that his death achieved, all that he went through. And in your mind, when you're tempted, say, don't even think of it. Christian, don't even think of it. Remember the blood that was shed. What shall we then say? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may abound? By no means. We died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? The paraphrase of that particular passage in Romans puts it well when it says, and shall we then go on to sin that grace may more abound? Great God forbid that such a thought should in my breast be found. With Christ the Lord we died to sin. With him to life we rise, to life which now begun on earth is perfect in the skies. Too long enthralled to Satan's sway, we now are slaves no more. For Christ hath vanquished death and sin, our freedom to restore. so on this Good Friday, as our minds focus upon that cross of Calvary, let us thank God that Christ's death was anticipated, that Christ's death was accomplished. And I trust that Christ's death by you has already been appropriated and by the power of the Holy Spirit applied to your life. And if it hasn't, then before this Good Friday evening comes to an end, come to Christ and be wonderfully saved. Let's pray. Lord God Almighty, we thank you for your great plan of salvation. We thank you that the crimson thread of redemption runs through the pages of the Old Testament right into the New Testament. We thank you, Lord, that you are God, that you are on the throne. Would you remind us of these facts even in these days, these times through which we are passing? Thank you, Lord God, that Christ's death was anticipated. Thank you, too, that his death was accomplished. Thank you that he set his face steadfastly towards Jerusalem, and there on that lonely hill outside the city wall, suffered and bled and died for us. Lord, we think not only of the mental turmoil he endured, the physical suffering he endured, but we think of how the sin of the world, our sin, was pressed down upon his pure and spotless soul. Thank you that he did it all for us. And Heavenly Father, we pray that those amongst us tonight who profess saving faith in Christ, we pray, Lord, that mindful of these things, we may renew our faith in him and our love for him, and that we may pledge ourselves afresh to his royal cause. And Lord, should there be those in this building tonight, or Lord, those listening at home tonight, who know all these facts in their head, but the facts have never sunk down to become a saving reality in their hearts, oh Lord, we pray that this would be the night that they would recognize that Christ's death must be appropriated, Christ's death must be applied to their own hearts and lives. So we pray by the power of your Spirit, Lord, that such a transaction would take place and that there would be those who would wend their way to Calvary and find forgiveness of sins, fullness of life, life everlasting through faith in the Lord Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. Our concluding hymn is, I am not skilled to understand what God hath willed, what God has planned. I only know at his right hand stands one who is my Savior. We remain seated. Let us praise God.
I am not skilled to understand what God hath willed, what God has planned. I only know at his right hand stands one who is my Savior. I take him at his word indeed, Christ died for sin. My Savior.
Stand for the benediction. May the grace of the Lord Jesus, the love of God our Heavenly Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be our portion on this Good Friday evening, over this Easter season, and forevermore. And the people of God said, Amen. Please be seated. Follow the directions of the stewards as you leave.